I'm your host, Paul Constantine. I'm an assistant professor in the Applied Math and Stats Department. We're very, very excited to have Professor Mark Embree here for a very special Embree Days colloquium. But we'll kick it off with our now famous AMS colloquium correspondents, Jessica and Izzy. We're going to tell us about what? Dinosaurs? Well, here we go. Jessica and Izzy.
So as many of you may know or may not know, yesterday marked the beginning of a very special tradition we have here at Mines, that is E-Days.
So some of you might be wondering why your students didn't show up to class today. We're going to give you a little bit of insight into the E-Days tradition and then dive into kind of how math relates to it, because math obviously relates to everything. So every year, Matt comes up with a cheesy theme. So there's been mystery days and fantasy days and galaxy days and around the world in 80 days. But it seems like
they're totally running out of bad puns. This year is prehistory days, which doesn't, I mean, they just wanted to add dinosaurs into the mix, which like I can totally be on board with.
Yeah.
But so we wanted to talk to you about something prehistoric and dinosaurs with E-Days and math. So math doesn't often show up into popular media, like books or movies, but one of the ones where it actually plays a really big role in it is Jurassic Park. And so one of the main characters is a mathematician, Ian Malcolm. I actually haven't seen it in a really long time, so this is all via online. So someone correct me if I make a bad Jurassic Park slip, please. So he is a specialist in chaos theory, which was just becoming more of a thing right when the book Jurassic Park came out. So he like tries to slip in some like knowledge about chaos theory throughout the book and throughout the movie. In the book as well, every single chapter starts with a picture, a graphic of a fractal. And as you go throughout the chapters, it goes like first iteration, second iteration, third iteration, and just continues like that throughout the book.
Apparently, when they realize that the weights of the animals are normally distributed, they're like, whoa. That's too normal for an artificial population, so something must be wrong. It's like a big turning point in the book.
But apparently they also call it a Poisson normal distribution, which doesn't really make sense. But someone we found online says that he uses it in his probability courses to say, like, hey, this is a normal distribution, which is fun.
A little scary, yeah.
So also, the animation of the dinosaurs has a lot to do with the mathematics as well, and different matrices, computational, linear algebra, animating dinosaurs is a lot of mathematical work.
What do you mean animated dinosaurs?
The dinosaurs in the movie are all animated.
They're real.
No, they all, math did a great job in this case. Maybe dinosaurs. So also, as many of you know, April is Math and Stats Awareness Month, so for this edition of our Math and Stats Awareness Month, we're making a PSA about the March for Science, which is happening tomorrow at Civic Center Park at 10 a.m. They're on their website, they say that their goal is that it's really just a celebration of science to help the public be aware of the massive role that science and mathematics plays in our everyday lives. So if you want to go to that, you're encouraged.
Kind of the ultimate culmination of Math and Stats Awareness Month.
Yeah, it's also birthday. So on a completely unrelated note.
Completely unrelated. We just stumbled upon this paper
not
that
have to do with E-Days at all.
Happened to deal with the fermentation of beer.
In this paper, it's actually from CU Boulder, which, all right. But they create a model that it's actually a couple of models that models different parts of the fermentation process. So one of them actually models like the flavor and aroma of the final product, which is really interesting. Apparently there's one chemical compound that when there's too much of it in your in your brew, it makes like this weird buttery flavor that no one really likes in their beer. But it's super interesting that like such a subjective thing as flavor and aroma could be modeled using these equations.
And prior to this model, they said that there really weren't enough good beer fermentation models out there to be able to optimize the process of making beer. And so the goal of this model was to be able to introduce some optimization into that process. And this paper was written in the mid-90s, so that's probably why the beer today is so good.
Yeah. So, as you sip a beer this weekend, think mathematics. And with that,
math all, folks.
Thank you very much, Jessica and Izzy. It is now my pleasure to introduce Professor Mark Embree. So, Mark, the setting for our interview today is a place you may recognize as the dining hall of Balliol College at Oxford.
I do indeed.
Yes. So, Mark, thank you for visiting us, the Colorado School of Mines AMS Colloquium, for this special Embree Days Colloquium. It's the second time I've made that joke, and it won't be the last. So you're a professor of mathematics at Virginia Tech. You've been there since about 2014. Before that, you were at Rice University in the Department of Computational and Applied Mathematics, which is abbreviated CAAM.
That's right.
You actually include the and in there, so abbreviated. And you were there since 2001. Today you're going to tell us about some applications of some cool matrix decompositions with inside some engineering applications.
Yeah, yes indeed.
So you're also well known for a book on pseudospectra with Nick Trefethen. So what is a pseudospectrum and why is it important?
Wow, my elevator pitch for pseudospectra.
Yeah.
Pseudospectra are generalizations of the eigenvalues of a matrix, or the spectrum of an operator, that give you insight into matrices and operators that are not self-adjoint. Book is about these sets that generalize the spectrum, but also more generally about how we understand dynamics that are associated with non-self-adjoint or non-symmetric matrices and operators. So how dynamical systems behave on short time scales that might be stable on long time scales but grow in a transient regime and so forth.
Yeah, so I like talking to people about the fluid dynamics part, right? The sort of the linearized stability analysis doesn't always work with the fluid dynamics,
right?
Because of pseudospectra.
That's one explanation. So the fluid dynamicist is a political field. So yes, that there's a linear there's a linear phase at which some flows exhibit some transient but linear growth that could feed a nonlinearity and lead to an instability. So eigenvalues alone don't answer questions about stability nonlinear systems.
So you're the division leader for the new computational modeling and data analysis undergraduate major at Virginia Tech. Can you tell us a little bit about the motivation and sort of the vision for that program?
Sure. So a group of faculty came together before I came to Virginia Tech to map out a new major that would span computer science, math, and statistics, along with some applications. These faculty that were at Virginia Tech put this program together and developed the idea for 10 new courses, so it's not some program that's been pieced together from existing classes, but it's a genuinely sort of fresh new curriculum. How do you teach modeling and data and high-performance computing together in a way that can support one another? And so we launched this major in spring of 2015. We'll have about 20 students graduate in May. We have about under 60 in the next class, about 100 each in the classes behind that, so about 300 students in the major right now. So it's really become very popular with our students, popular with industry. We're really excited to see it take off, and it's been a lot of fun.
Cool. Congratulations. So you were the PhD advisor for our very own Jeff Hokinson. So you, Jeff, and some others in your group built a physics-based eigenvalue eigenvector laboratory at Rice, which was a site. It was beautiful. So what's next on your to-do list for bringing mathematical concepts to life and making them tangible?
Sure. So first of all, I should say Jeff built much of the lab, really, in the machine shop. Quite a feat, and it was a lab that stood as a fourth optional credit that accompanied our junior level linear algebra class. And because you learn linear algebra, you can see those ideas in effect with circuits and with vibrating pendula and with beads on a string, forward problems, inverse problems. It was really a neat physical lab. And so I'd like to build something similar at Virginia Tech. We play around with Plotney plates and we've done a few other circuit examples. We also have this big building that also is a kind of lab. The next thing on my agenda, actually, though, is to try to implement the nonlinear eigenvalue problem involving a string and particular boundaries. Building, yep.
Yeah. Awesome. So what sorts of things do you do other than applying to computational math?
Yeah, well, I'm family, so three kids and a wife, and so I spend as much time with them as I can. I lead a youth group at our church as well, so take some time, and I'm not doing that. I like to do some woodworking. Nice hobby. I enjoy doing something, you know, that it's an area where there are people who do things I can only ever dream of doing, yet they don't even know what an eigenvalue is. Sad to say there are people like that in the world, but man, can they do it.
Yeah. Cool. Well, we're really excited for your talk. We have a gift for you from our department. It's not have to do with woodworking, unfortunately.
Oh, well,
but you can take a look at that.
Okay.
I will switch the computer here. Do what I need. Go. All right, Mark Embree.
Thank you all very much. It's been a really wonderful day. Thank you, Paul and Jeff and Andrew and old friends and new friends. It's really been a pleasure to get to see all of you today and learn a little bit of some of the great things going on here at Mines. I'd love to tell you today about application of linear algebra to learn about an instrumented building. And this is work that really is due to a fantastic colleague of mine in mechanical engineering called Pablo Tarazaga in the smart infrastructure lab that he's built. And also a graduate student of mine, Jonathan Baker, and my math colleague, Sirkan Ershin. Some of you know his work in model order reduction. So the project really begins with Goodwin Hall, which is the home of some of our mechanical engineers and engineering education department at Virginia Tech. It's a new building that opened in fall of 2015, and my colleague Pablo Tarazaga had the foresight at the time the building was being constructed to install 212 accelerometers welded to the steel frame of this building with all of the cabling to lead these accelerometers to data acquisition devices all at the time of construction. So this is a very large building, the flagship building of the College of Engineering, and indeed one of the most instrumented buildings in the world. And so really have this great opportunity to learn about building dynamics by reading these accelerometers. Here's Pablo Tarazaga and his group, quite a few mechanical engineers, but also an interdisciplinary team that spans many different departments. So there are other buildings that have been instrumented similarly, for example, for earthquake detection in California, but this is the first time we've really instrumented a building with so many accelerometers with the intention not just of detecting structural faults in a building or the vibrational modes of a building, but really understanding as much as we can about how buildings are occupied by the basis of their vibrations. So here's one floor of Goodwin Hall to give you some idea of how these accelerometers are deployed. You can see this particular part of the fourth floor has one hallway that's very heavily instrumented to allow us to do some studies of pedestrian gait along the hallway. But we also have accelerometers deployed in throughout the floor and indeed throughout the building, where you see three accelerometers that are all mounted together, where you see a one that's a single axis accelerometer of the kind that's shown in the small picture in the bottom right. That's a three-axis accelerometer, and you can see the picture is a little dark. There's a single-axis accelerometer on the left, and then one of those three-axis accelerometers that's actually deployed on the right. And the orange cables then all lead off to data acquisition devices. And so these vibrometers can detect very subtle vibrations in the steel frame to which they're welded, and thus in, say, the floor of the building. Here's a little bit of the data acquisition device, so you can imagine all of the cabling that has to come together, and we want all of these accelerometers to be synchronized so that we can actually detect the signals in a coherent way. Here's a picture of what we're seeing from the building. You can see there are little wave packets that come along, some quite close together, some more diffuse, and this video will just loop around. You can see some accelerometers seem to all detect the same wave packets, others maybe detect something different kinds of wave packets. And so what we seek is, you know, we have 212 of these kinds of traces, and from them we want to understand something of what's going on in the building. Okay, so now just imagine for a second what you could learn from this kind of data about a building. So you can learn things about structure, certainly, but just imagine, you know, tons about what actually happens in a building. A few things we're interested in. Well, the modes of vibration. So when the building is designed, the engineers have a CAD model of the building, and they can do some tests to see how the building will vibrate. We can actually compare what we've done, you know, what the building is actually doing to what was designed. We can tell where people are in the building from their footsteps. So we can begin to understand when students are coming into the building, at times of classes, when classes change, for example. If we know students are going to come into a building at a certain time, we can cool off rooms just in advance of their arrival, so the rooms are nicely air-conditioned when they get in, but also that the air conditioning is not running all night long, for example. We can identify when some significant event happens in the building. So one of the applications that sort of spin-off company is interested in is to detect when someone falls in a nursing home. Can you detect what the vibrational signature is of a human being who falls to the ground? How is that different from a book falling or a door slamming shut? Maybe you can locate where those events occur. So you don't just identify that they've happened, but you can say, it happened somewhere on the third floor in this particular hallway. Send someone there to help. Can you identify emergencies? Can you tell, for example, if there's a gunshot in a building? Can you tell if there's been an earthquake or some other structural damage to a building? Maybe if you can tell that, you could actually then track an emergency in real time. So not only do you know, say, that there's been an earthquake and part of the building is failing, but you can tell where people are from their footsteps, and you can give them evacuation instructions, and you can help them out. Not only that, you can also tell if they're disobeying your evacuation instructions and doing something different, and then maybe you can adapt your instructions to help them get out. So the tagline that we have is that the building should be the first responder to an emergency. Rather than waiting for fire and rescue to arrive on the scene, let's try to get the building to help get its occupants out safely in the case of an emergency. Okay, so a few of these applications. First of all, building modes. So these are always a little tricky to play. You're not going to want to play nicely. So let me escape from here. Show you these things. So that's the second mode of the building. You can see it twisting. And these modes are detected just from the ambient vibrations of the building. We're not driving the building at a certain frequency. The building administrators got a little worried when we wanted to bring a special truck to the building that would shake it. Here's the first mode. And you can see the building sort of tilting. So you can begin to detect what these...
I think people don't like to know this, do they?
What's that?
People don't like to know that buildings move around.
No, they don't move around quite this much. They can be slightly...
If you're at the top of a tall building, you can feel this kind of thing.
Yes, they really do sway, indeed. And, yes. Okay, here's another image. Let's see if this will look really nice. This is how the building is occupied. It's a heat map of the accelerometers on the first floor. You can see the time at the beginning. So you can see students coming in. It turns out they don't show up right at 8 o'clock. It's like 8:02 that they show up when it really gets hot. And then throughout the day, you see the red circles, high activity at the times when classes change, and then sometimes slightly quieter. Not much is happening in this corner of the building. It's pretty quiet all the time, for the most part. So we begin to see where people are in the building. Just a very simple measure of the building. Another thing we're doing, again, this is showing up rather dark, but this company that I mentioned is trying to detect falls in nursing homes. It's asked us to perform some experiments with Rescue Randy. Poor Rescue Randy is a 200-pound dummy that gets rigged up onto this apparatus here, and the best way to drop him is to hook him up with a piece of parachute cord and then to snip the cord and well, you can see what happens. So we want to know, boom, there he goes to the ground. And so we want to see, you know, can we tell what this signature looks like, again, compared to, say, a book falling or a door slamming shut, or people just walking down the hallway. I've taken far too much enjoyment from that. Okay, so I want to describe a couple of specific applications that involve a little bit of linear algebra, what we're learning from this project. So the first is gunshot identification. So some members of the lab went to a local shooting range with three weapons, an 8mm pistol, a 20-gauge shotgun, and an AR-15, and rigged up a platform with one of these accelerometers attached to it so we could study the vibrations of that platform as the shooter fired the weapon. And the goal is, can we detect different kinds of gunshots from the vibrations that we detect on this platform. And so here are three examples of a pistol, shotgun, and rifle. And if you look at those, you can see, wow, that's interesting. The pistol's got a little blip that shows up there. The shotgun's got a larger secondary blip there. The rifle, we don't see anything like that. Maybe just from looking at these three examples, you might be hopeful that we can actually tell these kinds of weapons apart. And so we build a matrix. We build a matrix for each of these weapons. And here I'm showing you a column of the matrix just as a cartoon, so you can see how we load the data from one of these vibration studies into the matrix. Of course, we have more tests than just these five, but you get a sense of what these matrices will look like. So larger entries, zeros, larger entries. So we have a pistol matrix, a shotgun matrix. And when we have a matrix of data like this, well, one of the linear algebras, the first thing that comes to mind when we want to analyze subspaces that characterize these different weapons is to take the data matrix and to perform the singular value decomposition. And so I hope you all have come to know and love the singular value decomposition. It's a way of taking a matrix, maybe that has low rank, so maybe it doesn't quite have its rank equal to the number of columns here. And so we'll find a orthonormal basis for that column space. Those will form the columns of the matrix B. And then similarly, an orthonormal basis for the row space of this matrix, W transpose on the right. The central matrix, sigma, has non-negative entries that decay monotonically. So the largest entry here decays, and the relative size of these entries tell us how dominant the first few columns of, say, V are as a basis for the range of A. And so, what we're interested in doing is taking an A, taking the leading components of B, and building then some representative version of what A is doing. So how positive those sigma entries are will give us a sense. So here's what those sigma entries look like for these three different matrices. We have twice as many pistol data snapshots as we do for the other weapons because we have two different stances there, so the matrix is larger. The singular values, they decay monotonically, and this is pretty representative of what you see from many data science problems. The singular values tend to decay somewhat slowly on this logarithmic scale, but still the first, say, 20 are about an order of magnitude larger than the subsequent. So there's some real dominance in those early singular values, which causes us to expect the first few columns of V to be a dominant description of this data set. And so we can come up with a lower rank approximation that uses only a few of those columns, for example. And that's often a very convenient way to compress this data set. And if we do that, we make an error in this approximation with the leading portion of the data. How large is that error? It's the first of these singular values that we've forgotten about. So if we keep only k columns, the k plus first singular value tells us the error in our approximation. So that's a really convenient measure of how well we're doing. Okay, so for this we take 41 dimensional subspaces and we build these basis matrices for the three guns, and then we use only some subset of our data to build those, and we forget about other data. We use this some subset as a training set, and then we want to know how well do we approximate subsequent shots from the pistol subspace, the shotgun subspace, and the rifle subspace. So it's just a simple least squares approximation, the most elementary thing you can do. Some of you are thinking, I've got a fancier method than that. Good, good, good. This is just an illustration of how something even so basic can really work well. So we want to compute these orthogonal projections onto the pistol subspace and then see how much mismatch we have. We take our new shot, we look at how much of it was in the pistol subspace and how much of it we missed. So we build this orthogonal projector as an outer product of these column vectors and their transpose, and we get out some projector matrix, and then we'll apply that to our snapshot. And here's what happens when we do this experiment on our new data. So we had about another 60 shots from the pistol that we hadn't used to form our training subset, and I'm showing you here how much error we get when we try to identify those pistol subshots with pistol subspace, shotgun subspace, or rifle subspace. So blue is good, it means a great approximation. Yellow and green mean we don't have such a good approximation. So what we see here is that indeed the pistol shots are very well approximated by that subspace, The shotgun shots pretty well, the rifle shots pretty well. If I just look at which of these subspaces get the smallest error, well indeed, the smallest error, we get all the pistol ones right, we miss one of the shotguns, and we find all the rifle shots. So just with a very simple method, we can already begin to detect what kind of weapon is being used in one of these shots. So of course, there's much more to do to test this on things that aren't pistol shots and see if we get anything similar. Preliminary work, but it gives you some idea that there's promise here in these vibrations. Much data is included here. Okay. A little bit about our second application, trying to detect gait in the building, trying to detect human beings walking down the hallway. And this is work that's going on with this company, which is called GAiTE, G-A-I-T-E, and was also the subject of Dustin Bale's master's thesis. Okay, so here's this idea. Remember this layout of the accelerometers on the fourth floor. We're gonna do experiments in this hallway up here. It's heavily instrumented. And so we'll send a number of different people walking down the hallway. Every time they step, they're leaving waves coming out of each footstep, okay? A wave packet with each step. And so we'd like to then be able to identify those and come to understand. Here's what that looks like. Every spike that you see here is another footstep read off of one of those sensors. And so you see there's some basic noise here, and then there's a small peak there. That's probably because the walker is far from the sensor. And then they're getting closer, and you see the amplitude grow and then decay. So here's probably when they were right on top of the sensor. If I actually zoom in, I see that what looked like a sharp peak here is actually this wave packet of the four going up and down and then kind of trailing off. You say, ah, it's interesting, the noise is different here than it is here. There's lots and lots of richness in this data. Let's look at some more snapshots from different sensors. Here's one particular experiment, and I show you these to indicate the data is not all crystal clear, right? You can see there's some ambient kind of motion in the accelerometers, followed by these nice peaks. And on some accelerometers, they're a little clearer. On some, I don't see them at all. Really, this seems to be drifting. So this is real data for a mathematician. This is getting a little dirty. This is why we like to simulate data with Gaussian noise, right? This is not what Gaussian is. Okay, so this is a man walking down the hallway in sneakers, I guess. There's a woman in high heels. You can see the difference in the same accelerometers. You can see the difference in the signal. We still get a drift here, but look at the difference in amplitude. We're concentrated steps. This one still seems a little wonky, right? I don't, maybe a few spikes there. I'm not sure. Sometimes these accelerometers are just drifting or offline. Okay. So what do we do to analyze this data? Well, again, we build a matrix A. This is just a cartoon that kind of indicates that we get some positive and some negative entries as this signal oscillates. Each column is one of these accelerometer tracks. So I would take all of these entries, plus and minus, and I would form them into this first column. And the next accelerometer would give me the second column. So here I've shown you just a little cartoon. And in reality, we might have half a million to a million rows of the matrix, and then we're using, in this case, 14 accelerometers, so they're just 14 sensors. We're not using the whole 220, 212 in the building, only a subset. Okay, so that's where we get our data matrix. That's what the singular values of this matrix look like. So a dominant singular value and an almost an order of magnitude decrease, and then they kind of taper off more gradually. 20 different experiments, 20 different curves. The behavior of these data sets is all very similar.
Why is it all one for the largest?
I'm normalized, okay. Yeah. Okay, so what would we like to be able to do? Well, we've got this great building with actually pretty expensive deployment of accelerometers, right? You can imagine four data acquisition systems, 212 accelerometers throughout the building that were welded at the time of construction. What if I want to go into this building and I want to deploy similar technology here, right? Well, how would I be able to do that? Maybe I don't want that many accelerometers. I want to use fewer. I want to figure out where to place them strategically so as to get the richest picture of this building. And maybe I want to figure out how to do that with cheaper accelerometers. So all of these things are being investigated by the lab and by this company that's working on these problems. And so what we're going to try to use is linear algebra to look at that matrix of 14 accelerometers and figure out what were the key accelerometers that we wanted to use from that set. So just again, a small scale example of how to instrument, say, one hallway. Maybe if you have a security application, you're interested in just looking at one narrow piece of the building. So I love the singular value decomposition. So it pains me a little bit to critique it, but critique it we must. If I look at my matrix A, I've drawn this cartoon to show, say, a matrix A that has all blue entries in it, meaning all positive entries. And when I compute my singular value decomposition, I'm going to get a basis for the column space of A. And because all the entries here are positive, it's maybe no surprise that all the entries in that first singular vector are positive. But I told you that these vectors are orthonormal. And so if the second vector is orthogonal to the first vector, and the first vector is all positive, the second vector better have some negative entries in it. And so immediately that second column has these beige and white entries in it that indicate something very different from what we have in the data set. So if I want to try to understand, say, representative columns in my matrix, I'm not going to learn that so well by looking at the singular vectors. Because the singular vectors, after I get past that first one, actually don't look an awful lot like my data to begin with. So maybe my data could be integer valued in some applications, or non-negative other properties here. I lose all that in the singular value decomposition. And so in the last decade or so, there's been a new class of decompositions that's attracted some attention. When our goal is to not so much optimally compress A onto a subspace, but rather to identify from A representative columns and representative rows. So for example, if my A was a matrix of, from the Netflix problem, where I've got movies and I've got Netflix customers here, and I fill it up with the ratings of the movies, maybe I'd like to figure out representative Netflix customers as opposed to figuring out a basis for a subspace. So this class of decompositions are called CUR factorizations, and the idea is that I want to express A as possibly a low rank factorization, where instead of having the singular vectors here, I actually have columns that I've extracted directly from A. So this data perfectly captures the spirit of A. And R, similarly, will be exactly extracted from rows of A. This matrix U in the middle no longer will be this pristine diagonal matrix. In this case, it's got some huge entries in it. And so I have to be aware of that, that U will now be allowed to be messy. I'm going to choose it to make this a good approximation. And so maybe I don't want to come up with a factorization, I want to come up only with an approximation. And so I'll only take a few leading rows that I want to keep. That's often a common application. Maybe I don't care about the rows, and so rather than have that big U matrix there with large entries in it, I will just have some X matrix here, so columns times some other matrix, or rows, some other matrix times rows. You can do those kinds of things too. These are called interpolatory factorizations. Why? Because they're interpolating columns or rows of your data matrix. A really neat class of applications. And our rich history, going back at least to Pete Stewart working on column-pivoted QR factorizations in the late 90s, and you can use column-pivoted QR, rank-revealing QR, to get some good approximations. It's a very nice method for computing CUR factorizations. Other class of algorithms to try to maximize the volume of a matrix by selecting certain columns. If you have an enormous data set, you can uniformly sample the data, and so you're randomly drawing columns out, seeing how well that captures the data. A popular class of algorithms are based on something called leverage scores, which you extract from the singular vectors. And it comes motivated by statistics and nice theoretical properties behind leverage scores. The algorithm that I'll say a couple words about today is one that Dan Sorensen and I have worked on based on a technique for model order reduction called empirical interpolation. It too will use the singular value decomposition, so it's not meant to be a cheap alternative to the SVD. It's meant to take the SVD and say, what can we use the wisdom of the SVD to figure out what columns or rows are most important or most representative of our data set. So what can we hope this approximation gives us? Well, we know that the best approximation of rank K is given by the error is given by the singular value decomposition. And so its error is the first neglected singular value, that sigma K plus one we talked about earlier. So I'll never do better than that. So already I have a baseline.
But the idea is that maybe I can prove for my technique that I'm guaranteed to get within some factor, C2 there, of the optimal approximation, okay, the true norm. In the theoretical computer science literature, they often adjust this question a little bit. They allow an oversampling of the columns and rows in order to get within some factor 1 plus epsilon of an optimal rank K approximation measured in the Frobenius norm. So there's an extensive literature in theoretical computer science about this problem. Right? To take a slightly cruder approach and just look for bounds like this. And so here's our goal. We take the singular value decomposition, and we're going to somehow extract columns to form C and extract rows to form R. And then what will U be? I haven't said much about it aside from the fact it can have big entries. This is going to sound like a bad idea if we have a large problem. I'm going to build it by the pseudo-inverse of C times A times the pseudo-inverse of R. And some of you are scoffing now at the expense, right? That seems indulgent. But really, maybe I'm not actually going to form U. Maybe I just really care about identifying C or identifying R. It's often the application. So don't worry already. We can talk about it during the questions about forming. But you can do that. And it turns out that minimizes the norm of the error. And so to study the error, it turns out you can do the following trick. You take your matrix of singular vectors, and you look at the first k columns that you're focused on. And you've identified certain key rows and certain key columns, and you extract out those k row indices or k column indices from your singular vector matrices. So we take these big matrices of singular vectors and we extract out a little k by k submatrix. And once you've done that, you can actually prove, regardless of how you picked your C and your R, that the approximation, which must always be at least as bad as the first neglected singular value, is bounded by an error term times that first neglected singular value. And that error term depends on the conditioning of these k by k submatrices of the singular vector matrix. So this gives you a great tool for figuring out how to pick rows and columns. Pick rows and columns that give you well-conditioned blocks of your singular vectors. And then you can imagine algorithms that would then build upon that. So we developed this theory with the thought of analyzing a particular CR factorization. Elsa Ipsen pointed out this applies to them all. She's right. It doesn't matter how you got your rows and columns, this analysis still holds.
So do you need conditions for those to be invertible?
It's possible you could choose. I mean, you could choose badly and have those be non-invertible. Yeah. So you could have a really bad algorithm that did that.
Okay.
The algorithm I will describe will guarantee invertibility, but they could be exponentially large in K. But like Gaussian elimination, with partial pivoting, which in theory can have an exponentially growing growth factor that is never observed in practice, so we've never observed exponential growth of those constants in practice with our method, but you can construct examples that show that. Okay, so here's the idea, just if that went by a little unclearly. Here's our V matrix. Remember, the first column in this case, they all positive, the next one orthogonal to it, so it's got some negative entries in it. I'm going to maybe greedily pick the biggest entry in that first singular vector as my first index, my first row index. And then I just have to worry about the size of the inverse of that one-by-one matrix. I can invert that. Measure the size, right? So if I want to make that inverse as small as possible, I'll pick the biggest entry here, right? But I want to have more than a rank one approximation. So now I'll sort of do this greedy approach to get the first row, and now I'll try to come up with the second row to make this 2x2 matrix as well conditioned as possible. So I do that, and so then I maybe pick a third row that gives me a well conditioned 3x3, 4x4, 5x5. So you get the idea. And so finally, you know, here's a rank 8 approximation. Got an 8x8 matrix there that hopefully is well conditioned. That's just the whole idea of how you pick rows and columns. I can go into the details of our algorithm maybe during the Q&A period. I don't want to dwell on those. The method is called the discrete empirical interpolation method for model order reduction. It has a nice rich history there. And as I said, it's a greedy method that tries to find well conditioned B and W submatrices. Okay, cool. Oftentimes it converges very well. In this particular random matrix I've constructed here, we've got a decaying singular value. And the black line, that's the optimal approximation, and our method gives this blue line. Another method based on leverage scores, these other lines. So you can see, at least in one case, it does really well. It's not always this good, but it's often similar. Okay, so what does this have to do with the building? Back to the building. We've got our data from those GAiTE examples of people walking across the floor. We fill out a data matrix. And here what we want to do is extract the most relevant or the most representative columns of A, representing which sensors we should keep. So that's the way we're going to use this algorithm. So you can see, first of all, if we use this algorithm to construct low-rank approximations to this data, we do pretty well. The red line are the error in our CUR approximations. The blue line is the optimal error if we use singular values. Okay, so that gives us some confidence we're getting decent approximations out. And then here's an experiment I'll do to figure out which sensors are most important. I have 20 different experiments, 20 different people walking down, you know, experiments with someone walking down the hallway. 8 men, 8 women, 3 trials each. So I've got quite a bit of data from these different subjects. And they're walking left in the building. Now, I was just given this data set. I don't know what left means in the context of this building, okay? And what I'll do is I'll just take half of the sensors. Suppose I wanted to cut my sensor expense in half. I'll pick the most representative 7, and I'll do this for all of my different experiments, 60 different trials, 20 times 3, and I'll see which of those sensors showed up as among the most prominent 7 in each of those 60 experiments. And what you see is very interesting. There are 5 of them that in almost all of the cases showed up as the most important sensors. And 2 of them that were also pretty often there. There was one, sensor 10, that was never chosen as one of the most important 7 in any of these 60 trials. Okay, so this gives us a way that, you know, we can do further investigation to see which of these we want to keep, and are they all really as useful as we think. Now these are people walking, that was just one set of experiments, people walking left. What if someone's coming in the opposite direction down the hallway? We get basically the same results, same sensors. Again, 10 is left out, right? Suspicious in there. We can look at what sensor 10 is doing, and you see, yeah, occasionally it gets some data here, but often it's just kind of rambling along, one of those noisy sensors. So it's good that we don't pick that as one of the things that illuminate our data set. Put them together, we see which of these 7 really pop out. So I want to close with just one last example. So what I looked at before, it admittedly was fairly sterile. It's one person walking down the hallway. In a building, of course, I've got maybe people going every which way. And so if I just have this little cartoon here, I'm imagining my sensors being these blue dots. And as someone starts walking, as someone takes a step, what you'll see are arcs that come off of each footstep. And some of those arcs will hit this accelerometer first and this accelerometer. And we're even just assuming maybe by constant speed of propagation. And as they take another step, they're setting off another series of wave packets. At the same time, imagine someone walking from down here, and they've got more wave packets, and their footsteps hit these accelerometers first. And these wave packets tend to hit these first, and then there's a mix-up in the middle, and as more footsteps take place, there are more vibrations in there. You want one more shot? No, it just won't do it. Yeah, sorry about that. So my student Jonathan Baker's been analyzing. This is just a little 1D toy model to begin to get our heads around this idea. So he's imagining that you have sensors deployed at these different positions across the horizontal axis, and the time at which they detect a wave packet hitting them are shown here as these black circles. So each sensor detects 3 wave packets coming in at different times. And so we imagine there are 3 different events, 3 different footsteps, but maybe the footsteps that were causing this event here is different from the footstep that causes the event at the opposite end of the hallway. And so we want to be able to figure out if waves are traveling at a constant speed, which events go with which of these wave packets at each accelerometer are associated with which event, which footstep. And so he's got a nice clustering algorithm where he assigns, in a preliminary way, different wave packets to different sensors, to different events, and then he iterates, and he draws these, you know, if those assignments were correct, then you know, waves are traveling at a constant speed, what would the events be? And so he sees, well, these don't go through the times very well, we need to come up with new trajectories for our waves traveling through the floor. And so he iterates and is making, on each iteration, new assignments of this, these data points. And you can see finally you get something that's converging and seems to be pretty good assignments here. He's finding the lines that go through the data pretty well. And a couple of guys over there, maybe you want to argue about, maybe you say, you know, here we've got two green circles. So that means that accelerometer saw an event twice, but it didn't see this event. That doesn't seem to be right. So we iterate some more, and eventually, well, now we made the other mistake, and we keep iterating, and finally, this is what it'll do. So it did end up assigning two to that one, two wave packets at the same time. But overall, the actual events were located at those big gray dots. And here, this clustering approach did a pretty decent job of assigning which of these wave packets to assign to. Toy model. Lots of what I've shown you today. Pristine environments, point models. This is the beginning of a big project to try to understand how we can develop smart infrastructure using applied math. And so yeah, it's really just such a great opportunity to have a laboratory like this to do all these kinds of experiments. Linear algebra, can never learn enough of it. Even basic tools give us some insight. These interpolatory decompositions can begin to do things like detect how to deploy sensors or how many sensors we need. Of course, there are many. There's much work to be done. It's already been done in things like sensor placement, sensor networks. There's much work that's been done in understanding localization of signals through GPS, for example, that some of that applies to what we're doing. We've gotten into any of those details. The message I want to leave you with is, you know, there's much good work to be done to really deploy this in the wild. It's been a really fun project. It's a challenge sometimes to work in an interdisciplinary setting with messy data, but that's life, and it's fun to work on a project that hopefully will have some really neat impact in the future. Thank you all. Questions for Mark?
Where is sensor 10?
You know, this is the frustration of, we were given the data set, but we were not given the sensor locations. So we didn't control that. So when I showed you Rescue Randy dropping, we have total control over those experiments because we're doing them ourselves. And so I have all that data.
There's an old professor that's going
on. I know. Yeah, that was almost the professor who was complaining about the noise we were making when we were dropping Rescue Randy. It almost became a subject.
Yeah, I have all kinds of questions. Is your algorithm for computing the CUR, this is for my linear algebra class, backwards stable?
Ah, it's a backwards stable. So I would say probably not, in the sense of growth of it. It's very similar to Gaussian elimination of partial derivatives. So growth factors that can grow exponentially in some settings. And so that those kinds of settings will really throw you off. But in practice, it's incredibly. So it is almost, I could go into the details in the after colloquium to show you exactly how it is basically Gaussian elimination, usually. It's really the key idea, applied to the V matrix.
Do the sensors know which direction the waves are coming from?
Nope. It's just one point, and suddenly going up and down. Okay. That's all you see, is something hit. It doesn't have any sense of directionality.
You mentioned that one of the things that you would like to explore is comparing the model, the structural models, to the data. Have you had a chance to do that?
Yeah, Thompson Thomas said he hasn't given us this yet.
Okay.
I'm not sure they will. Yeah, it would be very interesting to get.
So what are some of the dimensions of these matrices that you're actually working with?
So we can, when we do things like mobile analysis, we might just sample
in on the order of 1,000 samples a second, and just ambiently collect data that one of the graduate students in the lab is actually collecting that data and then doing operational mode analysis on it to detect these modes in the building. But if we want to do those dummy drop experiments, we'll sample at least 4096 samples per second, and we might detect for 10 or 20 seconds. We can go as high as, you know, an order of 20,000 samples a second. Data gets really big, pretty fast.
So it's really tall.
Really tall. And skinny, though. So at most, we have 220 columns.
Okay.
Yeah, so as long as one dimension is small, you can do amazing things. And so, for example, computing the SVD. Gosh, my method requires you to compute the SVD. MATLAB's economy-sized SVD actually works amazingly well if one of the dimensions is small. So that's enough. But you can do this algorithm with randomized SVDs.
Seen these interpolatory decompositions anywhere else in like structural dynamics?
I haven't seen them deployed in structural dynamics.
Okay.
But I wouldn't be surprised if they're starting to pop up there.
Because you're applying this directly on SVD, right?
Yeah.
Which is like the POD that they principle.
Yeah. So in that case, these methods are used quite heavily in nonlinear model order reduction, where you have a nonlinear dynamical system. And if you do POD on that dynamical system, you end up compressing your state space dimension, but then to evaluate your nonlinearity, you might take your short state vector, and then you have to expand it in the basis. You get a long vector, you evaluate the nonlinearity on that full order vector, and then you compress it back down. And that's a very expensive step. So sometimes in POD on these nonlinear models, you've actually reduced the dimension of your system, but you haven't reduced the work. It can actually be more expensive to do POD sometimes. And so these methods really had a breakthrough 5 to 10 years ago for nonlinear model order reduction. It basically allow you to skip that step of taking your short state vector and extending it to a full order state vector. And so the idea is that if you just evaluate your function at certain indices, which you can compute cheaply, so you only form a few of those entries in that extended state vector. You evaluate the nonlinear function, and then that can give you a very accurate reproduction. So in that case, it's been used quite heavily. It's quite closely tied to POD.
MATLAB, really the software you're using for this?
Yeah, that's fine for what we've done here. If we wanted to do more computationally intensive things, we might choose something else, but this is just fine for us.
Yeah.
It also works well with the engineers, so they're very comfortable writing algorithms in MATLAB to convert the data files that come in from their accelerometers into MATLAB, and that seems to be a little more frank than they would. Yeah, what sort of problems would cause it to give you this exponential growth?
Yeah.
So we can construct very specific examples that have kind of a pathological structure, but that doesn't look like any real data set that you would see. And so I don't have a good tool for measuring that, aside from the fact that, you know, if we want to evaluate these error constants, that's just the norm of the inverse of a small matrix, so you can monitor that. And so if you monitor that and you see that that's growing, then you might just say, something's going wrong, let's throw in some random columns or random rows or do something different to try to improve. So the nice thing about this is this error bound gives you something that's very easy to check if you have your singular vectors.
Do you have any seismic activity in Blacksburg that you need to worry about?
Well, they detected an Oklahoma earthquake. There was an earthquake in Oklahoma not too long ago, and there's increased seismic activity there in recent years. And there was a particularly strong tremor, and they detected it. There's a seismic station at Blacksburg Airport, which is not a big airport. That seismograph picked it up, and then, you know, however long later, they pick it up at the building. They can see all the accelerometers in the building jump with the
Any other questions? All right, well, let's thank Mark. Also want to say, we'll stick around for the next hour. You're welcome to hang out, ask Mark more detailed technical questions, of which I have a handful. And otherwise, let me plug my computer back in just real quick, and I will tell you all about the next colloquium.
So thank you for sticking around for our special Embree Day colloquium. I told you I'd make that joke again. So our next colloquium is next Friday. It's James Warren from National Institute of Standards and Technology. This is going to be a joint colloquium with material science. And he's going to tell us about big data, materials, genome kind of project stuff. So this will be really, really, really cool. So think about next Friday for colloquium, and we'll see you all then, and happy E-Days.